What's up, everyone? It's Claire. Thank you guys so much for coming back to my YouTube. Who knew finances could be so exciting? What an exciting day today. We are going to get into how I funded, fixed, and flipped a property with none of my own money and none of my own credit. So I want you guys to smash that like button and we'll get started. I want to talk about how I found the property, and how that was is that it was the good old door knocking. And a lot of you guys go, well, I don't want to do door knocking. I get it. During the time that I did it, we didn't have this crazy economy that we are in now. I wouldn't necessarily suggest door knocking at the moment. I don't think someone would open their door for a random stranger. At least I wouldn't. So I would understand why somebody else wouldn't. And if you're a female, please go with somebody, okay? Make sure that you have a buddy system going on. Do not go by yourself. It took me almost 2 to 3 months of consistently door knocking, and I door knocked NODs. What are NODs? Notice of default. So you almost have a little less than 4 months if you go into default after not paying your payments for more than 2 months. Then you are considered NOD, which you are going into like danger zone, and you really should get out. In that situation, as an investor, we problem solve, okay? This actually didn't come from an NOD. What actually happened was that the guy who was in notice of default, saying that he wasn't in notice of default, that he was working it out with the bank, which I hope he was. And when that happened, he said, hey, there's a house down the street that has been vacant for a very long time. And we're like, okay, let's go look at the house. And he's like, it's the pink house. So we call her Pinky the whole time. We still call her Pinky to this day. That was when you have a pink house, you call her Pinky. I don't know. It's just a thing, I guess. So we left the card in the doorway, and just so happens that the seller calls. And it actually wasn't necessarily the seller, but it was the guy who was the executor to the estate. Someone, his father passed away, and so he needed to sell a house to have the heirs receive money. They didn't want the house because it needed a lot of work, and they just didn't have the money to fix it up. Now, I think a lot of people make the mistake of going out to a property and just money hungry and trying to get their money, when here's the thing, guys, these people are going through a lot. And if you're putting your house for sale, typically, not always, you're going through some form of a problem, whether it not be a divorce, whether it be you lost somebody, your mom, your dad, your grandparents, whatever the case may be. So your job is to really hear them out. Because here's the thing, if you were in the same situation, you wouldn't want someone coming into your doors and being like, you know, I don't really care about you, but I just want your property, okay? I think that's the reason why I've also been very successful, is because I can really relate to a lot of people. I've been into a lot of situations, but I'm also not to the point where I need your property so much that I'm just gonna overlook anything that you have to say. So I see a lot of wholesalers out there, they're just like, I want properties, properties tomorrow, property this, property that. And it's like, slow down, talk to the person. It's a human being at the end of the day, okay? So he saw us, and he saw that we were understand where he's coming from. We didn't push him. He was like kind of on his own time frame, and so we made sure that we were on that time frame. And you know, people are going to do what you know, as long as you are doing the right things, people are going to respond to that in a positive manner. So when it happened, and we got the call, he actually had an offer that was higher than us. Now, do I know that for a fact? No. There's no way to know, okay, guys? When an agent on a listing says that there's another offer, do you know if there's another offer? You don't, okay? You trust but verify. There's no way to verify in this situation if he was telling the truth or not. However, the offer was higher. And so we said, hey, we can't go any higher than 136. We just can't do it. So he said yes to it. He agreed it. And I will say this. Typically, the highest offer, that doesn't mean that someone's going to take your offer just because you're the high offer, okay? I really want to make that very clear, because I think people go in just because you offer the highest number. That doesn't mean that they're going to accept the highest offer. And typically, it still has to appraise, okay? So we then got it under contract, and then we turned to each other And we're like, do you have the money? No. Do you have the money? No. How are we gonna do this? Okay? Like, that's literally what happened. We're like, okay, we don't have the money, guys. What are we gonna do? But you figure it out real quick. And you need to come up with a game plan. You need to come up on how you're gonna do it. Are you gonna raise the full amount? Are you gonna raise the rehab amount? Or are you going to go to a hard money lender and get the funding that way? Now, with a hard money lender, you will have to show credit. But does it have to be your credit? No, because in the situation that it was for me, I didn't have to, it wasn't my credit, okay? So I had someone else who qualified for the loan and everything. And then the 15%, so it was actually, it was 85% ARV. So that's the after repair value. So each money lender is different, depending on your experience too, depends on your interest rate, depends on the points. All of it depends. Now, do I recommend a hard money lender? I'm not a big fan of hard money lenders because I really, they kind of gouge you in certain places. And sometimes by the time you're done paying all their fees, the deal doesn't make sense anymore. I don't do anything that's at least $30,000 in profit, like at the least. And in this market, I don't even know if I would do $30,000. I would probably up it to $40,000 to $50,000 because in California, if $10,000 is like, boop, gone, okay? $10,000 is like taxes around here, okay, guys? Like, it's expensive. So I make sure that I'm well-equipped. Like, if I go over budget or in my rehab, like, there needs to be something, like, contingent. You need to have some safety net there. So 85% came from a hard money lender. The other 15%, which people are like, I don't know, I don't have the 15%. And that's typically what I hear across the board. And a lot of it comes from private money lenders. So that's your aunt, uncle, mom, dad. But it doesn't necessarily have to be that. It could be an acquaintance that you met that maybe you were networking at an event and you're like, hey, I'm gonna start doing this real estate, you know, and then the guy's like, hey, I don't really want, or the girl, hey, I don't really want to do like the legwork on it, but I have some money sitting here. If you guys want, I can get a return on my money, then I'm cool. So I already had a list built up at that point. So what did I do? And it still holds true to this day. I just go down my list of contacts and like, okay, I got a deal. Who's in? And you just go down the list. Okay. But if you don't have that list, you got to create that list. And that's not necessarily a buyer's list. This is not wholesaling, guys. This is you going out and flipping a property. So, and you need to have everything set up so you can take your deal to somebody else and say, okay, this is what I'm looking at. This is the return you'll get. This is how long it's gonna take. You need to set that person up, and this is the plan on how I'm going to do it. That's extremely important. If you're just going into this willy-nilly, you're in the wrong ship, okay? Your ship is going to have holes in it and you're going to sink and it's not going to be pretty and it's a lot of money on the line, guys. Sure that you guys have a solid game plan is how you guys are not going to lose, all right? So from there, what happened is that we got the money, we closed on the property, and then the rehab starts. And the rehab is extremely important, okay? You need to make sure that you have your contractor. I've spoke about this before, three references, license, bonded, insurance. They need to show proof of all of it. Everything. There needs to be a contract in place. There needs to be how you're going to pay them. There needs to be all of that stuff in place before he even starts on the project. Period. All right? He's going to say, well, I could start tomorrow. Okay, well, no, we need a contract in place. You have to make sure that you guys are doing it the right way, because here's the thing, a contractor will sink your ship if you are not set up properly, okay? Even though they're licensed and bonded, that doesn't mean anything. It just means that you can go after them. However, you don't want to go through that process. You want to make sure that you're set up. So if it goes over a certain time frame, what is that time frame? Is the time frame, you know, 30, 60, 90 days? After 90 days, he gets a penalty every single time he's late. What's the schedule look like? What's the budget look like? Making sure you guys are on the same page. And if you're a first-time investor and he knows that or she knows that, that's not a good thing. And the reason why is because contractors can take advantage of that situation, just like anybody could take advantage of you in that situation because you're new. So you want to make sure that you yourself project that you know what you're talking about. So what does that mean? You got to figure out the cost of everything. You got to figure out, okay, if I paint, if I put floors down, how much is that going to cost? Okay, if you don't know it, then that doesn't mean that the contractor is responsible for telling you. Okay, you need to take accountability for your own stuff. Okay, that's plain and simple. You need to know your stuff. And that goes across the board. It's my own personal thing. Never have seen a budget stay in budget, and I've never seen a contractor not be late. Now, if you guys have a different scenario, please comment below. I have never seen any of that. Okay, so you want to make sure you have 10, 15, 20% of your budget more than what you projected. It's always over budget. It's always over the time frame, unless you have it in the contract where if he's over a certain time frame, he owes you money, and typically contractors don't want to be at a loss. All of that needs to be factored into when you guys are doing it. So at that point, from there, everything is going smooth. We put it on the market. I don't have to pay commissions on one side because I am an agent at this point. So after all that, we made a $45,000 profit. You know, that's someone's, of $45,000, that's someone's salary for a year, okay? So for my next video, I'm gonna talk about the housing market and what my opinions and my thought process on it is. So that is going to be it for me today. Make sure you smash that like button, hit the subscribe, make sure you have the bell notification on because I will be posting 3 times a week. Isn't that exciting? Also, if you want, you can email me your questions on real estate, on how to get started. And then I have a Facebook group where you can join. So make sure you join that as well. And I will see you guys on the next one. Bye now.